clustering, and we talked about how to initialize the Lloyd's algorithm. Then we were talking about how do we actually pick k, and as I was indicating, it's not really a settled issue. I talked about hypothesis testing, and I think that's where we left off. And also I mentioned the kind of informal method called the elbow method. I did want to mention that there's some research also on something called stability methods for choosing k, which seem to have some, there's still some interest in this. I'll just mention how it works. There seems to be some advantages and disadvantages to it. So the idea is pretty simple, is you would do something like splitting the data into, and let's say you're doing k-means clustering. You try each k, and for each k, you split the data into and do it twice. So this is, say it looks like this, and then you do it a second time. It looks like this. And now we're going to measure some measure of similarity between these two clusters. There's actually a variety of ways you could measure similarity. So actually on page 11 and 12, I discussed that, but definition is not so important. I think you can see that we could easily define some notion of how similar these two clusterings are. For example, I can, for every pair of points, ask, are they on the same cluster or different clusters? And then I could also cluster them using these data points by finding the closest ones here and asking, are they on the same cluster or different cluster? That's a common way of doing it. And then just ask, on average, how many are clustered the same way from the two different, from the two different halves of the data. So you can define similarity of clustering. There's several ways you can define similarities of clustering. But the question I want to talk about is that a good way to measure whether you've got k correct or not? So there's quite a few papers on this. But an interesting thing is there's a paper by Ben David, Van Luxburg, and Paul in 2006 that just raises the question about whether is trying to choose stable clusterings the same as choosing good clusterings? And their answer is no. And I just wanted to go over the examples they present. I'm not sure this is definitive, but it does at least raise the question of whether stability is a good or bad thing for. So the examples are on the top of page 13. I'm just going to put them on the board here. So suppose you had, there's four examples here. And two of them are meant to show examples where using some notion of stability is somehow helping you choose a number of clusters, and then two examples where it's not so good. Okay, so they say suppose that you have clusters that look like this, but you know, and you can imagine we're doing this in higher dimensions where we can't just see the answer so easily. Suppose you had fit k equals to 2. So whatever your definition of cluster is, presumably we don't think there's two clusters there. What might happen in k-means, though, is something like this. We could get one cluster here. Because remember what k-means is trying to do. It's trying to minimize distances to the data points. And you can set it up, and they actually do this quite carefully. But you can see you are going to get an instability here. Because if I split the data in half and did this, and you could do this many times, you can see sometimes you might get this split, but sometimes it might split the data this way and so on. So you can see that if I repeat this many times over the data by splitting it or perturbing the data, you will get a very unstable result by taking k equals to 2. So in this case, you would rule out k equals to 2. You would say that's an unstable clustering. And that seems to be, you know, a reasonable thing there to say that the stability analysis, however you're doing it, is certainly revealed that that's not a good choice for k. And their second example looks like this. They say, suppose the data like this. So this is an example where it's telling you, by the way, you're underfitting. And they say, suppose your data look like this, and you fit k equals to 3. So you seem to be overfitting. So they'll say, well, sometimes you'll get something like, you know, like this, and then like this. And again, it's pretty clear that's unstable, because if I repeated this, I might get the opposite thing, right? I might get that I split it like this, and like this. And that would indeed be revealed if you did this on, say, splits of the data or perturbed versions of the data. So they're claiming this would correctly show you that you're taking k equals to 3, and from their point of view, k equals 3 is incorrect, and it's unstable, so you would conclude that's not true. Now, it's worth pointing out that the point of view I expressed on Tuesday, even if it was a bit vague, would be that k equals to 3 is not necessarily a bad thing. Because if I took k equals to 3 and then noticed that these clusters are overlapping, I would merge them and get back two clusters. So if you did the kind of overfitting and merging that I talked about, maybe this isn't so bad. But at least from the traditional point of view, this k equals to 3 would usually be considered overfitting. And they, as they point out, instability analysis would work. So now let's look at two examples, though, where they show that instability analysis fails you. And so they consider data like this. And they're saying, suppose I were to fit k equals to 2. So k equals to 2 seems to be underfitting. But this is very stable. If you fit k means here, think of this one as being pretty far up, actually. So then you're going to end up fitting something here and something here. That's where your cluster centers are going to be. And that's going to be perfectly stable. If you subsample the data and keep doing k-means with k, so you're gonna, it's not, those centers are not going to move very much. So you would say, oh, that's stable. And so you'd say, oh, maybe k equals to 2 is OK. And yet you can see you'd prefer to have k equals to 3 there. So this is their first example of a situation where maybe stability of clustering isn't really measuring what you want in terms of choosing k. And their second example looks like this, where they have, let's say, a small cluster here and a bigger cluster here. And now they're saying, well, you should choose k equals to 2, presumably. But what if you pick k equals to 3? Well, in this case, you're going to get, again, a stable answer. You're not going to get that flopping around that we got there. You're pretty much always going to get something like this. So the center means would be very, very stable. And so you'd conclude k equals to 3 is stable, and they consider that a failure of stability. Again, if we did some post-processing like merging, maybe it wouldn't be so bad after all. So at any rate, these are supposed to be examples where sometimes checking the stability of the clusters works, sometimes it doesn't. To me, again, it's not so clear that it's a failure, but nobody's worked out beyond that. I think this paper seems to have killed most of the research on using stability for choosing the number of clusters. That paper is referenced there on page 13. If you're interested in that, I would suggest looking at that paper. Yes?
Why do you think that's not very bad?
Here?
Yeah.
This one?
The one on
top. No, this one I agree with them that you'd want to choose. Yeah, so. In this case, stability certainly would be misleading you.
So if it's not stable, how do you know it's overfitting or not?
So that's the thing. They're implicitly assuming you want to choose k to minimize the instability. And that's not obvious to me, because it seems like it can be sometimes caused by overfitting and underfitting. And it seems to me it could be fixed in some cases. So for example, in this case, let's look at this case. It's true that this would be very stable. Let's call this the instability up here. If k was 1, it would be very stable. And the k equals to 2 is very stable. And k equals to 3 would also be stable. But maybe it would become more unstable, I don't know, at 4. And so maybe minimizing it isn't the right thing. Maybe finding the largest k where it becomes unstable or something like that. It's unclear. I think I think more research is needed on stability measures. Yeah.
Definitely seems similar to bootstrapping, and I'm wondering if there are like estimates of the competence involved with the centers of using k-means.
Oh, that's a good idea. So let's think of that. We're trying to estimate these parameters, the centers. maybe we should think of these as estimates, you know, after all, of the population centers. And that's a really good question. Can I try to get confidence sets for these, perhaps using the bootstrap? So the answer is, I think the answer is no. And the reason is because, so here's something I should have mentioned earlier, is that the risk, so here's the thing, there's these instabilities in k-means clustering. In fact, these kinds of instabilities are precisely reflecting this fact that, let's actually ask this question. Is it the case, you know, usually when to do confidence intervals bootstrapping, we need something like this. So, like, does this converge even to a normal distribution? The answer is, in general, no. If you put extra conditions down, the answer is yes. But in general, it turns out that there are counterexamples. And this relates to the fact that you can have two very different clusterings with very similar risk functions. Remember that the risk here of a set of clusters we will see in a minute that the empirical risk and the true risk are close to each other, and in fact uniformly close over C. But the two different sets of centers having similar risk does not imply that the cluster centers are close. There's a kind of lack of differentiability, you might say. And so I can move the cluster centers, you know, wildly around. These are kind of hinting at that, and have completely different cluster centers and yet have similar risk. So to put it another way, population risk actually doesn't have smooth derivatives with respect to C. And that's what causes the lack of this. The answer is, I'm not ruling out that you couldn't do confidence sets, but at least the naive methods like doing a bootstrap or something don't actually work. Now that you mention it, though, it's surprising now, I'm trying to think of why there isn't more work about trying to get confidence sets for these things. And nothing comes to mind right now, but maybe I'm just not remembering. But nothing comes to mind about trying to fix those problems.
Why the fact that it's undifferentiable is relevant to the fact that two different kind of clusters have the same sort of risk?
Because you would like to be able to say that, let's suppose I just had one cluster center, that as I move this, the risk changes. And what's happening here is that there are, maybe I should do this in higher dimensions, there are kind of, you can move the cluster centers around certain paths and not change the risk very much. And so there's like flat spots in the function. So like the second derivative, the eigenvalues of the second derivative would be not well behaved and so on. So there's actually, I should say, there is a paper that talks about this. It's by David Pollard, I'm going to say around 1982. And what he does have, so now it's coming back to me. He does have a central limit theorem for this, but you see that he has very, very specific conditions to rule out these kinds of things. Yeah, clusters are funny, you know, and it's going to get even funnier when we talk about mixtures in a minute. At any rate, I would say that when it comes to choosing K, what you can see is, just to conclude this discussion, is I don't really have good advice, because I see there's like the elbow method, there's the hypothesis testing, there's the stability methods. There seem to be papers suggesting that these are good things to do. There seems to be papers suggesting that they're bad things to do. And so I can't point to one that I can say has been shown. You know, a really good measure under very general conditions. Maybe you know one. Does anybody know of one that they find to be reliable? I'd like to know. It's always sort of an embarrassment teaching clustering because of this, right? You can't give a definite answer about what to do. There's other ones, too, I didn't talk about. Like, there's something called the gap statistic that's quite popular. I'm not a big fan. Because you have to put this for example, a giant rectangle around the data, and you use a uniform distribution over that as the null. And to me, that the null distribution there doesn't seem to be the correct null distribution. And there's lots of them. So yeah, at some point I just stopped and said, okay, that's enough of these k things. But we can say, there are some positive things we can say. So can I say that the risk estimator is close to the true risk, and in particular that the risk of the selected cluster centers So let's just review. I'm going to select, let's take k as given again, and I'm going to select some clusters using, and I'm going to run the algorithm. How do I do this again? Remember, I'm minimizing this numerical risk. Yeah, let's make it a function of c. But ideally, what we would like to do is, let's call it C star, which would be minimizing the population version of the risk. At least from the point of view of k-means clustering, this would be the optimal thing to do. So I'm going to now give you a result that says, at least in terms of risk, we are doing well. So if I take the true risk function, evaluated at the ones that we get from the data, and say, how well am I doing on average compared to the risk of the best clustering based on k? The answer is k so you can see that as k gets bigger, as I have more clusters, and as the dimension gets bigger, they, not surprisingly, the guarantees gets worse. Which just is the usual thing that, you know, it's kind of a curse of dimensionality both here in terms of the dimension and in terms of the number of clusters, which perhaps isn't so surprising. The way we prove this, I actually have the proof twice in the notes, so I have it in this section, but I also put it in the notes that are coming up that will be posted soon on concentration and measure. And this year, I think we'll go through the proof when we do the concentration of measure. I think it fits better there. So when we cover concentration and measure, which is coming up soon, we're going to go through this proof. It's not too difficult. And it's a nice use of VC theory. But the basis of the proof is to first show this, that if I look at the empirical risk compared to the true risk over all possible clusterings, the first thing to do is to bound that. And that's done using VC theory. Once we do that, this is not very hard to do. This is very similar to classification, where we show that the empirical risk and the true risk are close uniformly over all classifiers that we're considering. From that, getting that the classifier you selected from the data is close to optimal is very easy to do. It's this step that's most of the work. Okay, so for now, actually, I guess the proof, which is just the next half a page, you can just skip that, and we'll come back to it when we get, again, to concentration and measure. I do want to point out, though, that VC theory is not always doesn't always give you the tightest bounds. There's a slightly tighter bound on page 14. It's not that much better. It looks very similar to this. And they use more sophisticated methods. So I thought I'd put that there just for completeness. They also show a kind of a lower bound, which I can see looks like it has a typo in it. But you can also say that you can't do too much better than this in general. Yeah. Yeah. The expected value bounds come from the probabilistic bounds.
Oh, OK.
Did I include those in there? Yeah, the way we prove it actually is, so what he's asking is, instead of saying expected value, can I just say this holds with high probability? And the answer is yes. Okay, so that's kind of reassuring. At least we have some theoretical result there. And we'll prove that later. And but again, remember, let me just say that point again. And I should have put, I'm sorry, I didn't put examples like this in the notes, but I should have done it, which is that the risk being close doesn't mean that the cluster centers are close. Actually, here's a really, let me just make, here's a simple example of that. Just take it to be uniform over a disk and take k equals to 2. And I can put this cluster centers here, but I could just as well put the cluster centers here, and there won't be any difference in hardly at all in the risk, but the centers are completely far apart. So whenever there's symmetries like that, you can get the risk close together even though the centers are not. So these instabilities are what cause this discontinuity between the cluster centers and the risk. And you'll see, if you're interested and you look at Pollard's paper, he has a regularity condition which maybe is not so transparent, but it's essentially ruling out things like that. Okay. So that's k-means. That's only method number one. We want to go into other methods. I did put a little section here, 2.4, to just remind you of this comment that I really think that it's better to take k-large and have some sort of merging rule. It's probably a better way to do k-means, although the details never been worked out. But I want to move on to other methods because, of course, k-means is very popular because it's simple, it's kind of intuitive, it's fast, it's easy to implement. But there's plenty of other methods. So I thought the next natural method would be, in some sense, very similar to, but more general than k-means, which is to use mixture models. So, you know, in general, of course, a mixture model, let's just remind ourselves, first of all, that there's two ways to think about mixture models. So let's just start with a mixture of two distributions. So you just have, say, pi here, of course, is the number between 0 and 1. P1, P2 are just two different distributions. In a minute, we're going to take them to be Gaussians. But there's also, remember, the latent variable interpretation. And you can think of it from a generative point of view, which is I flip a coin, and with probability pi, I get heads, in which case I draw x from this one, and with probability 1 minus pi, I draw from this guy. And so it's convenient sometimes to introduce this latent variable, which is a Bernoulli with success probability pi. And then there's a joint distribution, really, for px and z. And what's happening, of course, is that this is px given z times p of z, okay, and if we observe z, that would make life easy. We'd be back into classification. The z's are like the labels that we don't see. The difference is that for clustering, we don't see the z's, so all we're really seeing is the marginal distribution of z. So written this way, what this is really is it's just the marginal. Px and z. Which is what this is. So you can think of it as just a definition of a density, or you can think of it as this latent variable representation. Why is the latent variable representation helpful? Where do we use that? Yeah, so for the algorithms, right? EM algorithm is based basically on this latent variable representation. And Gibbs sampling, if you're doing the Bayesian version, both use the latent variable representation. It's the same model. It's just a different representation of the same model. So the one, really, that gets used for clustering the most, which hopefully you did in 701 and 715, I'm sure you did, which is one of the most common methods for clustering, which would be a mixture of Gaussians. So it's going to look like this. We're going to have K. We're going to have K Gaussians. And now, by the way, the relationship between the number of components and the number of clusters gets much more complicated, actually, as I'll explain in a minute. So this will be a normal with a mean vector, mu j, and a covariance matrix, sigma j. There's a lot of parameters here, right? So we have to have these. Of course, these have to sum up to 1. So there's k minus 1 of these. Each one of these is a vector. Let's suppose xi is in dimension. Let's say we have a. Let's actually count the parameters here. So how many parameters are we estimating? The pi's have to sum up to 1. So there's k minus 1 of those. Each mu is d-dimensional, and there's k of them, so there's dk. And these covariance matrices in a d-dimensional space have order d squared parameters, right? And then there's k of those, so there's order k d squared. There's a lot of parameters we're estimating here. And of course, k is another parameter, which you know we have the same issue that we had for k-means clustering. You have to choose k somehow. All right, but anyway, the appeal of the model is that it's a pretty simple model conceptually, right? We're just fitting maybe a normal here, and a normal over here, and maybe a normal over here. The reason why I say the relationship between the number of components and the number of clusters is not obvious is because they're clearly not equal. For example, I could have another normal right here. Is that part of this? Is that a different cluster? Or is it just, are these two components making up one cluster with a weird shape? But it's actually more subtle than that. Because you might think something about, so this is actually pretty interesting. You're about to find out something that nobody else knows. Ready? Well, actually, only 3 other people know. Which is, you might think about the, how about the modes? Let's think about the modes of a normal. Actually, let's go to one dimension. Suppose I take a mixture of 2 Gaussians in one dimension. Let's take the variance as equal. So let's just take actually the simplest case. Equal variances. How many modes does that density have?
2.
Nope. You can have 1 or 2. If the mu's are far enough apart, it will have 2, you're right. But if the means are less than 2 standard deviations apart, this is actually a unimodal density. It actually looks like that. So the connection between the number of groups and normals is not clear. The relationship even between the number of modes of the density and number of components is not clear. In fact, here's a very cool thing. So I have this paper, which is going to appear on archive tomorrow. You're getting a 24-hour heads up. Where these people, where are they from? I'm going to say Germany by their names, have a paper saying, suppose we're in D dimensions. So I'm fitting K normals and in D dimensions. What is the maximum number of modes I can get, do you think? So here, by the way, the number of modes is 2 or 1. So it's at most, the maximum number of modes is 2. I have k components in general, in one dimension, the maximum number of modes is k. Now we go to d dimensions. Here's a very, very interesting thing. Let's call the maximum number of modes m. Anybody want to guess what it is? Is it k? Do you think you could actually get more modes than components? Well, we could certainly get less. If I just take them all really close together, you'll get 1 mode. But what's the maximum? I'm going to allow you now to try to create as many modes as you want. Yes, you can, exactly. If you arrange them just right, you can create these weird things. I'm going to tell you what the current answer is. Nobody knows is the answer. But these guys have a bound. on the maximum number. It's going to be surprising. First of all, that's a lower bound on the maximum number you can create. That's pretty big. And they have a sort of an upper bound. And I'm going to put a star here because there's a condition that is imposed for the upper bound that if you're violated, it could be even bigger than this. How about that? Is that strange? Yeah, you wouldn't think it's so complicated, but people are still writing papers about this, and it's very complicated. There's no easy answer to this. And this is actually not sharp because they're assuming here that all the critical values of the function satisfy a certain condition, which turns out not to always be the case, so this is under a certain restriction. And literally, this popped up a few minutes before class, so I thought, wow, what an opportunity, I'm going to tell you about it. So that you'll see on the R character what's called the maximum number of modes of a Gaussian mixtures, if you're interested. Okay. So anyway, these mixtures are complicated beasts, but at some practical level, you know, it seems like a reasonable thing to do to use them to fit clustering. So how are we going to do it? Well, the first thing is we have to estimate all these parameters. So we'll probably do maximum likelihood. So let's call all of the parameters theta. Keeping in mind now, this is a lot of parameters. But in principle, it's no problem, right? In principle, at least, this is, I'll just do this. In practice, as you know, so you did do this in 701, right? Yeah, in 715? Okay, so you know that the problem with this is that this likelihood's a mess. It's not definitely not concave or anything like that. And so you would have learned EM, which is the nice thing about the EM algorithm, the expectation maximization algorithm. Remember, it was how simple it is. You just two steps, expectation step and the maximization step. They use the latent variable representation. I'm not going to go over this because I'm assuming everybody knows this. I hope you've seen this before, right? Very simple algorithm, but of course there's no theoretical guarantees that are known for EM algorithm. We don't know if we're getting anywhere close to a maximum and so on. Nonetheless, people seem to find it, you know, works well in practice. And so I would say a very, very common thing to do is to just, almost everybody does this. You just do the EM algorithm. There are other, yeah.
It gives a local max.
It does give a local max, right, absolutely. There are other algorithms that have come up in the last few years based on what are called spectral algorithms. I haven't seen anyone actually use these in practice. They seem to be more research ideas. So I think it's too early to say whether they're useful in practice. From what I've heard from people who've tried them, they don't work so well, but it's intriguing because it's an alternative approach to EM. But I think in practice, EM is still the workhorse. So anyway, that's what we do. We fit these things using the EM algorithm for better or worse. You know, in k-means clustering, I mentioned there's k-means plus plus for choosing good starting values. I don't know of a good method for choosing starting values for the EM algorithm. You could just use k-means plus plus and use those as the starting values for the means. But I don't know of any theory that says that's a good thing to do. But it's probably not a bad thing to do in practice. Now, let's just assume we fit this mixture model. So let's suppose I do this, and let's suppose I get my MLE, or some approximation to the MLE. How do I get the clusters? What is the clusters here? How did you do it in 701? I mean, there's a few different ways you could do it. One is you could take each of those normals you've estimated, and with associated with each normal is an ellipse corresponding to its covariance matrix, you could just define that to be the cluster corresponding to that normal component. I would say the more common thing to do, though, is, let's just take one, with two components, is to compute the probability that the corresponding hidden label, let's say the hidden label could be 1 or 2, the hidden label is 1, given x. That's the most common thing, right? Is to say, what's the probability that the hidden label associated with that x came from that normal? And then we just do Bayes' theorem. That's the probability of x given z equals to 1 times the probability z equals to 1. Let's just say proportional. Well, let's actually write it out. This is an unknown quantity, but it depends only on the parameters of the model, which we've now estimated. So this is the normal associated with this guy. This is phi of x, mu 1 hat, sigma 1 hat. The probability z equals to 1 is pi hat, and so on. So in other words, we would just plug in the MLEs here. And of course, I did for 2, but it would be the same for k or for a multivariate case. So probably that's what you did in 701 and 715, is you can now compute the probability of membership. And so now you can assign, based on these probabilities, which one is it most, you can ask, what's the probability that this observation came from 1, 2, 3, and you can assign it, just like in classification, to its highest probability. That's considered one of the advantages of using mixture models, is you get this kind of soft clustering. You don't have to necessarily assign it just to this thing. You have a probability that it belongs to each of the k components. So it gives you this soft clustering, which is kind of nice. We still have the same problem of choosing k, and all the same issues apply. I would say in practice, there's a little bit more you can do here than in k-means. And probably the most common things are to use, remember in 705 we talked about AIC, BIC. So you can use things like that we talked about for doing model selection. You can even do cross-validation. You could use held out data. Think of this as you're estimating the density and do cross-validation and choose k. So because we have a generative model for using mixtures of normals, I think the problem of choosing k is a little bit less unclear than it is in k-means. It's one of the advantages, I think, of using mixtures over using k-means. By the way, what's the relationship between mixture models and k-means? How would I get back the k-means algorithm? Right, if you take the circular covariances and let them become small, then the EM algorithm becomes the k-means algorithm. So you can think of k-means as a special case of mixture models. All right, so I think it's safe to say that at some practical level, mixture models are very popular for clustering. Seem to work pretty well in practice and so on. There are a few issues with mixture models I wanted to mention, though. I call this is on page 19, I call mixture models the twilight zone of statistics. Now, you're probably too young, all of you. Have you ever heard of the twilight zone? Yes. Okay, some of you have. It was a great show, wasn't it? Yeah. Great TV show. You can probably find them on YouTube. It was a show in the 60s. All right, so I like to call the mixtures the twilight zone. What I mean by that is that as simple as the model is, it's a very conceptually simple model, but it has very, very strange behavior. And that doesn't mean you shouldn't use them. It just means you should be aware of it. Okay. So what do I mean? Well, first of all, computationally, we know finding the MLE is NP-hard. So that's already kind of, a bit of a problem. Another problem is that you're not really finding the MLE when you do this. So what do I mean by that? Something that they often don't tell you is that there are places where there are places in the parameter space where the likelihood is infinite. Namely, if you let one of the variances go to 0, So for example, set one of them, here's the data. Set one of the means equal to that data point and let sigma go to zero there. I can make the likelihood as big as I want. So that means if I say sigma one, the likelihood actually goes like this. At the boundaries of the space of the parameter space, the likelihood is infinite. So technically, the maximum likelihood, if we define it as the maximum, is you should be going to the boundaries of the space with infinite likelihood. So luckily there are non-boundary cases where there's nice local maxima. So that's what people mean when they talk about finding the MLE. We mean finding the interior modes. Everybody sort of understands that we're not talking about this. But you know, this can come up sometimes. Sometimes when you run the EM algorithm, this can happen. You can find some of your sigmas going to zero. And people usually just restart with a random restart. Or they build in a barrier so that you can't, you know, get the variances too small. So this can actually be a problem in practice. So that's another weird thing about mixtures. The next thing I already talked about, which is the multimodality of the density, that is that the number of modes is not related to the number of components in any simple way. We already talked about that. Another interesting thing about mixture models, they're not identifiable. We talked about identifiability when we did all the theory in 705. I said one basic property we need for consistency of the maximum likelihood, asymptotic normality, and all the nice stuff was that when theta 1 is not equal to theta 2, we insisted that the corresponding distributions were different. That's clearly not true in mixture models, and identifiability fails in two different ways, one that's innocuous and one that's not innocuous. So one way that it can fail is just by label switching. So I could say, oh, you know, I have this normal, say with mean 0, mean 1, and then 2/3. So there's a mixture model. I have 1/3 of the weight on this normal with mean 0, variance 1. Somebody else could say, no, I'm going to use a different density. So let's actually write down the parameters here. Pi is 1/3, mu 1 is 0, and so on. Sigma 1 is 1, mu 2 is 2, and so on. But I could just switch these and call this the first one. Obviously, that's exactly the same density. Technically, they're different points in the parameter space. Because here, pi is 2/3, mu 1 is 2, and so on. What that means is if I think about the parameter space, there are places where there are different points in the parameter space that correspond to exactly the same density. So technically, identifiability is violated. This is not a big deal, because who cares whether at the end of my EM algorithm I get this one out or this one, I'm getting the same density. It is an issue in Bayesian inference, because when you're doing GIP, if you do MCMC, you can get what's called label switching. You start bouncing back and forth between these. So people who do that, you need to do some, it's a very inefficient way to sample. So there are tricks, I guess, people use to try to avoid label switching. But there's a more subtle type of non-identifiability, which actually is a bit of a problem for us, at least for those of us who want to understand what's going on theoretically. This is called local non-identifiability. So let me show you what I'm talking about. Let's go to one dimension, and let's take the variances to be known. Variance is 1. So I'm just going to consider a very simple mixture. It's going to be 1 minus pi plus pi okay, so the unknown parameters here are pi, mu 1, and mu 2. So here's the problem. Let's suppose I tell you mu 1 is equal to mu 2. This is mu 1, density do I get? I get a normal. It's the same density here and here. So when I take the convex component, get back free. But what is the meaning of, we have this other parameter pi floating around. What's the value of pi? The answer is it's not well defined. When mu1 is equal to mu2, pi is an undefined parameter. So now I think about this is, this is pi. Once mu1 is equal to mu2, there's a ridge here along pi from 0 to 1 where I'm getting exactly, this refers to the same density. As I move along here, the likelihood is constant. Okay. And I have the same problem if pi is equal to 1, let's say, it just disappears. What's happening with mu1? When pi is equal to 1, every value of mu1 refers to the same density. It has no effect on the density.
I mean, that's a problem. I mean, if you're using, say, EEM algorithm, you just kind of end up at a point that, like, every neighborhood of this is maximum.
Right. So why is it a problem? Here's why. So let's see if I can draw this now. Can't draw three-dimensional space very well. So why is this a problem? The problem is, suppose now I wanted to do a hypothesis test of whether this was one component or two components. The problem is that under the null hypothesis, there are these whole sets where the likelihood is constant. And in fact, you can check the Fisher information, for example, is degenerate. What's happening? Because why? Because what's happening is, think about the null as being just intuitively along some ridge where the likelihood is constant along here. These are all the same density. There isn't a point corresponding, or even a nice subspace corresponding to the null distribution. There's these sets under the null. Let's say we're testing it in 1 versus 2, where the likelihood is the same. And these are infinite sets. The practical result of that is, suppose we tried to do something that we use from 705, like, say, the likelihood ratio test. Suppose I just do, forget about all this, I just say, here's a parametric model. I want to test that mu1 is equal to mu2, so that there's only one component. If you actually literally do the, remember what we do, we would compute the log likelihood under the alternative and under the null. What enabled us to do the test properly in 705 is we knew this converged to some chi-squared, so we could figure out how to get to when to reject the null hypothesis to get the correct type 1 error. This does not converge to a chi-squared distribution anymore. No one really knows what it converges to. So we can't construct, it's not constructive. We can't construct a valid test. But actually, we know things about this. It converges to the supremum of some Gaussian process. I mean, there is a lot known theoretically about it, but nothing that you could use to actually say, in practice, here's when you should reject and here's when you should not reject. So the practical implication of this, what's called local non-identifiability, is it thwarts us from using standard statistical methods to decide how to do a hypothesis test, whether I should use a mixture of three or four normals, for example. So this is an example where the theory becomes complicated because our regularity conditions are violated, but it has serious practical implications because ordinary hypothesis testing, if you try to use the chi-squared as your cutoff point, it's not going to work. You're going to end up making all kinds of crazy decisions. See, this really is the Twilight Zone. This is weird stuff, isn't it? Here's another thing, although this one I think's pretty easy to fit. Suppose I have, let's just take two normals. Let's say this one and this one. And now I compute, remember I can compute. Suppose I told you what these densities were, but Of course, since it's one-dimensional, I could estimate a mixture of two Gaussians pretty accurately. So you, say I give you enough data, you can estimate these pretty accurately. Now I actually want to assign things to clusters. Well, remember, what we're going to do, let's call this group 1 and group 2. What are you going to do? You're going to the usual thing to do is to compute this, like we talked about. But let's think about what this probability looks like. If I plot it, of course, the probability that the next over here came from group 1 is very high. Then it's very low. But guess what? It goes up again. Why? Because I made this variance a little bit bigger than this variance. So when you get to the tail, this one's higher than this one. That's very counterintuitive. That's not. If I get data that look like this, and I tell people, oh, this is from this cluster, most people would say there's something wrong with your clustering algorithm. So that's an unexpected thing. That one's easy to fix. You could just clip things, you know, or just use the, just say, I'm going to define the cluster to be the things where the, you know, you're within two standard deviations of the mean of that normal or something like that. So again, that's an easily fixable one, but it's going to happen to you in practice if you get outliers. So these are all things that can actually affect your algorithms. The last one, we know we can do all these things from a Bayesian point of view too. So I could take the likelihood, multiply it by prior. And that's how some people prefer to do clustering. And so we would get a posterior distribution on the parameters, and that's fine. You know, we would just usually using some Markov chain Monte Carlo. Did you do MCMC in 701? No? Should we do MCMC later in the course? I don't know. Yes? OK, so we'll add that to the list of things that I promise I'll cover. At any rate, we can certainly fit this model. But there is something else to be, you have to warn you about, which is will cause weird things in your algorithm when you actually run this if you're not careful about this. Let's just go back to the normal model for a minute. Suppose I was just fitting a normal. We talked a little bit in 705 about, you know, when people choose priors in practice, they often just choose something really for convenience. In fact, let's just take sigma to be 1. The most commonly chosen prior in practice is by far the constant prior, which is not a real prior, right? That's an improper prior. Improper meaning that this does not integrate. The reason why that's OK to do is because formally, if I multiply this prior by the likelihood, I still get a perfectly well-defined posterior distribution. Right? The posterior still integrates. So there's no problem using an improper prior in that case. You still get a well-defined posterior. Everything's great. Mixture models, by now you shouldn't be surprised, are different. And even if I take the simplest case, let's just say, let's say I even tell you that pi is a half, and I tell you the variance is 1. There's only two unknown parameters, mu1 and mu2. And what people did at first was they did the same thing. That doesn't work for mixtures. It turns out that, so in this case, let me just say that the likelihood times the prior, despite the fact that this is infinite, this is finite. That's the data converts the improper prior into a proper posterior. That doesn't happen here. In this case, the likelihood times the prior is infinite. And again, what that means in practice is you could get very divergent behavior if you're running a Markov chain Monte Carlo. So you don't even have a well-defined posterior. So people have come up with other ways to define priors that try to avoid this problem. But it's, again, something you have to be aware of if you're actually going to implement this. Just another example. Yeah? So we're going to have a lecture on Bayesian nonparametrics. That one I definitely promise. I've already got the notes for that one. So that one's a high confidence. Yeah, because in the Bayesian nonparametric approach, you would actually take k to be infinity, which is kind of interesting. But you still have this issue to deal with. The intuition? Oh, yeah, I can actually explain it intuitively. So think about, yeah, here's why. Think about the late, so remember we have n observations. And remember they also, you can think of them as having latent variables, which is telling you which group it comes from. And you can think of rewriting the distribution as the distribution given the z's times the probability of the z's. And depending on these z's, you're getting essentially, let's actually just say there's two observations just to keep it simple. Well, think about writing, again, p of x1, x2 as p of x1, x2 given z1 and z2 summed over the possible values z1 and z2. So you're summing up four distributions. This is just the likelihood so far we're talking about. But what are the possible values this can take? Well, this could be 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. But think about what happens in the case. So remember, it's a sum of these. One of the components is going to be the 1, 1 thing. But when both observations are from group 1, what's happening to group 2? You have, in this case, you have zero observations from group 2. And that means that the prior times the likelihood, there's no likelihood for mu 2. All you have is the prior. And so so when I sum this up, the contribution from this part, the prior times the likelihood for mu 2 is just the prior for mu 2. There's no likelihood. The likelihood's constant. And so you can that makes this infinite. I mean, that makes this, the posterior is now a sum, but some of the pieces are actually equal to the original prior. And that's it. That's improper. I don't know if that helped. But if you just think about all the possible assignments to the groups, as the sample size gets larger, net components get smaller and smaller and smaller. But unfortunately, it's an infinite. It still makes it infinity. So here's one. Actually, there's a way to fix it, though, which is essentially to throw away those groupings. So that's easy to do, actually, if you're doing Gibbs sampling, for example. Not maybe a bit harder to do with the EM algorithm or something like that. But if you're doing EM, you're not in the Bayesian. Yeah, forget that. It's like if you're doing Gibbs sampling, you could throw away bad groupings. You've technically not sampling from the posterior anymore, but it would keep it proper. So yeah, there are ways to fix this. So some of these are easy to fix, I think. This problem, this non-intuitive group membership. But the serious ones are, if you were trying to do confidence intervals, hypothesis testing, you know, the statistical theory for these mixture models, we don't know how to do it. It just violates all of the regularity conditions that we are used to having. So what's the bottom line in all this? Why am I telling you this? I'm not saying you shouldn't use mixture models. I mean, we all use them. They're very, very useful, and they can work very well in practice. But I just think if you're going to use them, you should just bear in mind, right, that they can have this unusual behavior. It's just a matter of understanding what you're doing and understanding that there are these complications. But I'm not saying you shouldn't use them. Okay, just use them with caution. All right, so that's mixtures. Any questions? We've done k-means, we've done mixtures. We've got a couple more to go through. Now I'm going to switch gears and talk about density-based methods. The reason why I'm covering so many different methods, because I think they all have different advantages and advantages. The advantage of the density-based methods is I think they're on firmer theoretical ground in some sense than k-means and mixture models. but they're a little bit harder to implement, especially in high dimensions. So what do I mean by density-based methods? There's a whole bunch of different density-based methods, but there's two very common ones, the two most important ones. So here's the idea. I'll just draw it in one dimension. Here's some arbitrary density function. We're no longer going to assume, you know, it's a mixture of normals or anything. It's just the density. And if I asked you, what do you even mean by a cluster? I think it's easier to say from the density, because I think what most people would say is, well, they're the high density regions. That's sort of what we mean by a cluster. So for any given T, I could define the level set, the upper level set. What's the notation? Are you called it LT in the notes? Okay. And so let's find the set where F is bigger, or P is bigger than T. So in this case, it's this. So this set can be decomposed into disjoint sets. Those are called the density clusters at level T. Right? That's pretty clear. And different T's will give me different clusters. So this is kind of like hierarchical clustering, because I'm going to get different clusterings for different T's. So the nice thing about this notion of clusters is I think the population quantity that we're thinking about, the density cluster, is a very clear, well-defined notion. And here's an interesting fact. So what happens is I change T, well, I get a tree, right? I think you can see that. As I move down, I'm going to get like another leaf forms here. But what happens when I get down to here? These two are going to merge. So this is called the cluster tree, or the density tree. Some people in CS call it a merge tree. What do I mean by this is just, if I call this the clusters at level T, then the cluster tree is just all of them. It's just the union of all these clusters. And they really are a tree in the following sense. If I pull out any of these two clusters, you can see what's going to happen is, like, if I look at this one, you can see this one is contained in this one, or this one is disjoint from this one. And that's the only possible relationships. For any A and B in here, either A is contained in B, or B is contained in A, or they're disjoint. And what that means is also is that we can actually, you know, I think it's pretty clear. If I were to draw this tree, it would look like this. There literally is a tree that we can draw. I didn't draw it so well. But you can draw a tree, which is just showing you how the density clusters are merging as a function of T. When people do density clustering this way, the goal is generally not to just pick a particular level, but to show you how the clustering varies as a function of levels. It's considered to be more informative. And so how do we do it in practice? Well, there's an easy part and there's a hard part. Since we just did density estimation, you can guess that what I'm going to do, I'm going to define the estimated level set, which is the set of all x's such that p hat. So for example, I'll take a kernel density estimator and compute this. That's easy. The hard part is, how do I actually find the connected components of this set? So this is going to be some set of points. But how do I know if two points are actually connected? So here's your estimated density. When I draw the picture, it's pretty clear this is a connected component, and this is a connected component, right? But now imagine doing this in higher dimensions. And you know, I have a density estimate over here. How do I know if two points are in the same connected component or not? If there exists some part of the density where the density is high here and goes like this here, they're going to be in the same connected component. But if there exists no such path, then they're not in the same connected component. But obviously, I can't check every possible path. It's actually this is a numerical problem, not a statistical problem. This, How do I check whether there exists a high density path, a path connecting those two points where p hat is always bigger than t? And you can't. I mean, not in any reasonable time. So what people usually do is they first find the set of points. You first find, what did I use for notation here? You first find a set of sample points where the density is bigger than t. And so now I know at least which sample points are bigger than t, but I still don't know which ones belong in the same connected component or not. And what we now do is we form what's called a Ripps graph, which is, I'm going to connect, I'm going to take these points. So let's suppose these are the data points. These are the set of points, the sample points, where the density is bigger than t, for some t. I'm going to do this for every t. How do I know the connected components? I'm going to form a graph, which is I'm going to connect two points if and only if they're less than some number apart, and I'm actually going to use, let's say, epsilon. So I might connect these two, these two, these two, these two, these two, these two. And now I'm going to just say I have a graph. There are fast algorithms for saying, find me the connected components of the graph. So I can quickly find this is the connected component, and this is the connected component. And I'm going to suggest that you set epsilon to be equal to the bandwidth that you're using for the density estimator. There are actually some theoretical reasons for doing that. So there you go. This is pretty complete. Let's think about what we would do. You get your data. You do your kernel density estimator. You have to pick one tuning parameter only, which is the bandwidth. But we already talked that there's methods for doing that, say cross-validation. Now, for every t, you just find the points that are bigger than t. You form this graph, and you find the connected components. Now you get your cluster tree. Now, you might think, that's inefficient to do this separately for every t. I should keep track of what I did at the last t. So if you're, you know, if you're taking an algorithms course, you know that there are fast ways to do that. But I'm terrible at programming. Luckily, other people have done this for us. So I know of at least two that are actually from our department. So one is in, I have, if you want to try them out, the links are here. One is in Python, for you Python fans. One is in R, for us R fans. And I'm sure there's other, I'm sure there's MATLAB versions of this and so on. And it just does exactly what I just said, and it does it all very quickly for you. And so what do you get out? What you get out are these beautiful pictures. I just did some simple ones here. What you see on the right, and I'm just doing some simple two-dimensional examples. What you see on the right are, this is the, and what's, this is the output from this is actually, I think, from the R package. It's, the package is called Debacle. It stands for density-based clustering. And you get this nice cluster tree. And then here's a more complicated one. The nice thing about this is it doesn't matter what dimension the data are in. You still get this nice two-dimensional plot of the clusters.
What is the x-axis on those tree plots?
Here?
Yeah.
So that's a very good question. So this tree looks like this. But what is the x-axis? The y-axis is clear. It's the height of the density. The x-axis is arbitrary. So there's a rule made up in the program. The x-axis isn't meaningful, right? So at the bottom of the density, there's just one cluster. When it splits, it just arbitrarily, I think in the program, it might just go to the halfway point here. And then it just, when it splits again, it goes to the halfway point here. So I could kind of permute how this is the next, and that's meaningless. It's sort of the price you're paying for going from an arbitrary dimension into just a two-dimensional plot. Because you are, obviously you can't capture the d-dimensional information about the location of the clusters. So So that's one way of doing density clustering. Let's talk about what the advantages and disadvantages are. Well, I think the population quantity we're estimating is very clearly specified. A little bit murkier, as we've talked about, for k-means, I think, and for mixture models. There's a single tuning parameter, which is the bandwidth, and we at least know something about how to choose it, for example, cross-validation. Now, having said that, we don't know that using cross-validation to choose the bandwidth for a density estimator necessarily gives you the best cluster estimates. That's not necessarily the same thing. So maybe, you know, one could argue that we still don't know how to choose the tuning parameter, but at least we know something about it. I think we know more about choosing H in a density framework than we know about choosing K and K-means, for example. However, there's a disadvantage, which is, you know, density estimation suffers from the curse of dimensionality. And what's going to happen in high dimensions? Well, what's going to happen in high dimensions is if you have some well-separated, well-defined clusters, I think you'll still find them even in high dimensions. So you might be estimating the density poorly in the L2 metric, but you'll still probably find the well-separated clusters. But if there are subtle clusters, you know, things that are hard to find, you're probably not going to do very well with density estimation, because density estimation, as we know that doesn't work really well in high dimensions. So there are limitations to density clustering. I'll tell you about one interesting, just an anecdote, and we shouldn't draw too much anecdote, but the guy who wrote this Python code, his name is Brian Kent, by the way. He was a graduate student at CMU. He now works at, I forget the name of it, one of these startups that does kind of data mining stuff. He came to me and he said, you know, I'm going to try my program on this following example. He had a bunch of people, and he had their parts of their genome measured. And it was like, I'm going to say 10,000 features on each person, like 10,000 SNPs. SNPs are single nucleotide polymorphisms, like single letters in the genome. And I said, Brian, you can't do 10,000 dimensional density estimation. That's not going to work. He said, well, let me try it and see what happens. So he just ran it. And he got this cluster tree, you know, something that was much more complicated. And then he said, well, how can I verify that this tree makes any sense? So he got some sort of tree. It was a pretty complicated looking tree. Well, he went and got extra information, namely, where are these people from? He was able to get the geographic location. And sure enough, you know, this was like North America, Asia, Europe, you know, Scandinavia. It really broke down very nicely into the geographic regions. So that was an example, just again an anecdote, of a very, very high dimensional density clustering that had some sort of validation to it. But that he might have got lucky. You know, they're probably not all so easy. And in fact, when we talk about it, we haven't talked about high dimensional clustering yet. When we talk about that, we'll see that there's definitely some obviously there's going to be challenges in doing high dimensional clustering, and there are different ways to try to deal with that. Just blindly doing density clustering may or may not be the best thing to do. In his case, it worked out pretty good. Okay. Let's see. Any questions? Does anybody here use density clustering? Oh, okay. Maybe you'll try it out. How do you find the number of clusters? So I guess the point of view here in this type of clustering is that it's a meaningless question, they would say. Because what they want you to look at is the entire cluster structure. Rather than saying there are five clusters or six. So they would say it depends what level of resolution you're looking at in some sense. Now, you could do something like, well, I want a cluster 95% of the data. So you could do this. You could keep coming down until you've captured, say, 95% of the data. That corresponds to, say, cutting here. And then you say there's two clusters. Oh, there is another approach, which we'll talk about in a minute, which is called persistence, which corresponds to basically trying to cut where there's large branches. Any other questions about this version of density clustering? Let me give you a theoretical result. The other nice thing about this is, as I said, for k-means and for mixture models, it's very hard to do the theory. But because this is based on densities and we understand density estimates pretty well, there's a lot of theory about density clusters. There's no shortage of really good theory. And an example of this is on page 24, which says that under certain conditions, which I'll explain in a minute, the level set that you're estimating and the true level set are this far apart. Let's take some, let me just explain what I'm talking about here. What's H? H is a good thing to know about. This is called the Hausdorff distance. Remember what L is, it's a set, right? It's a set of all x's bigger than some cutoff, as is L hat. There's actually a term missing here. I feel like there should be an h squared there too. The Hausdorff distance is a metric between sets. So this is a good thing to know about. Anytime you have to compare two sets, you have to pick a metric, and there's different metrics. The most stringent metric, I think, is the Hausdorff metric, and here's how it's defined. If I give you a set A and a set B, how do I define this distance? So here's what you do. First of all, I'm going to take the points in A, and I'm going to put a ball around every point. So I'm going to take a ball of size epsilon around every point in A and take the union. So what does that correspond to doing? That's like growing the set by epsilon. And now what I'm going to do is keep growing it until I engulf B. So I take the smallest epsilon so that this set engulfs this. Let's call that epsilon 1. And then I repeat the process over here. I go over here and I start to enlarge the set, and I keep doing it until I engulf B. Let's call that epsilon 2, or engulf A. And then I take the maximum of those two numbers. And a lot is known. This defines the distance between sets, and a lot is known about that distance. And this is often a way people do theoretical results about various types of clustering, and in particular density clustering, is usually studied using the Hausdorff distance. It's kind of like the L infinity distance between functions. It has the same kind of, but the indicator functions for the two. Let's not get into that. We're running out of time. But anyway, this is like the L infinity distance. And so this gives you some control over this. However, it's not true. There's some regularity conditions. And in particular, this cannot possibly be true, this result, at every level. There are some levels where you can't really get the level set well. If I have flat spots in the density, when I cut here, you can see little small changes here can cause, you know, this. If this density estimator came out a bit here, then my level set would be here. But if this sort of pops down a bit here, all of a sudden I've got a thing here. So there are some level sets that are kind of stable, which means that the level set doesn't change much as I move it around. And there are some that have these instabilities, like when there's going to be critical values and so on. So this, obviously, you can't estimate some level sets accurately. It's just impossible. So this result applies only to the stable level sets. That's what the condition is stating on page 24. All right, so we have more to say about density clustering. There's another approach to density clustering called the mean shift algorithm. How many of you have heard of the mean shift algorithm? Okay, it's funny because in computer vision they use it all the time, but it seems like in statistics and ML it's not used very much. But it's a pretty cool algorithm. So what day is today? Tuesday or Thursday? Thursday. Sure about that? Yeah, good. All right. That's good news. So what'll happen then, so let me tell you what the plan is, you know, because Ryan's off taking care of some baby or something. I have to update the plan of the class. So I think on Monday, or Tuesday rather, we're going to finish the clustering. I'll talk about other aspects of clustering. Then I've injected something. Remember I promised at some point I'm going to do high dimensional two-sample testing. So I actually am going to cover that next. That'll be on Tuesday or Thursday. And then we'll probably go into concentration of measures, so those notes will be going up soon. The two-sample testing notes just went up, so they're up on the website now.